Ellie, it is extremely difficult, and we did manage to find the remains of a carcass, and at the base of this beautiful bush. Have a look at this. Looking around, searching. Is that what we're doing, James? We're searching. A leopard. Yes, a leopard indeed. Now, this looks like it might be Thandi, everyone. I'm not sure yet. Can't see. It's lying in the thick bush. I'm hoping that because it is cooler, these leopards will move around, and I'm sure that Thandi and her cub are both here. There was a fair amount of meat left on the carcass, so I don't think they're quite finished feeding just yet, or at least enough for them to still feed on. So we'll have a look, we'll have a look around this area, and we'll spend some time here and hopefully get these leopards moving around and being a little bit more active. But I think some nice teamwork finding these leopards, James. So James spotted the kill and the leopard. I just drove him in the right direction.
You did find the tracks going off. Fair enough. We'll call it teamwork.
Right, yeah. But just look how well camouflaged this leopard is and hidden. Right in the in that dense little thicket, in that little bush. Now, I wonder where the other leopard is. It's possibly lying in the long grass there somewhere too. We just can't see it. So we'll have a little look around here shortly. Let's see if we can find the other leopard. But isn't this a nice surprise? We were hoping to find a leopard. Unfortunately for us, there was a leopard in the area with the kill. Now, this kill, I think, was possibly done yesterday at some point, maybe with that weather that we had, the rain. And I know a lot of viewers always ask, are the predators more active in the rain, or how does the rain affect them? And I've always said that in my experience, leopards especially, leopards and lions, but leopards especially, often after a storm or a bit of rain or wind, these predators do often have a kill the next day. I think it's because it's easier for them to hunt in weather like that. It's windy, it's rainy, it's making a noise, it's easier for them to stalk and pounce on prey. So I think it does definitely benefit them in some way. Ah, beautiful fish eagle calling in the distance. We're not far from Chitwa Dam, in fact. Calling off down to my right. We can't see them, well, I can't see them, but the fish eagle was calling.
Aaron, you've got about 160 to name.
So you asked what birds stay for the winter. Well, Kelly, there are a number of species that stay for the winter. I'll just sit still here for a little bit. See how this leopard reacts to us. Looks like... Now, this is definitely Thandi. I'm just going to sit very still. She's giving a little growl. We're not too close from her. But I'm going to keep my voice down a little bit and sit very still. Don't want to disturb her in any way. Oh, look, they've opened that carcass, and you can see they've been breaking some of those ribs, some of those bones. Now, this female leopard has done very, very well, because that is a large impala ram. Now this, I feel, may be because of the start of the rutting season. We've mentioned it a few times before. The males, when they are rutting, they are so occupied with with fighting with one another that they often forget to have a look around for predators. And that is, at this time of year, you find a lot of male impala fall prey to predators. Is that correct, James?
I would say so, Byron.
No, well, there we go. We agree on something. Oh, this is great. Just as I was saying, that hopefully this leopard gets a bit active because it is cool. There is still some meat there. She fortunately got up and started feeding. So this is fantastic. This is really very special. Yes, Diane, it is indeed a huge impala carcass. So a great meal for these two leopards, for this female and her youngster. Again, I cannot see the young leopard anywhere, the young male. Nicholas, these leopards will indeed feed on some of the bones, not the large bones, but the smaller bones, and you'll hear her cracking through some of those rib bones, and that they will definitely feed on some of the bone. Oh, look at that. There are some other people around. Look at those eyes, keeping a watchful eye out. Now, interesting thing with these leopards, when they are feeding, you'll notice that most of the time, one leopard will feed at a time. Even if this female has got a cub nearby, the young male, she will feed first, and then she'll, when she's finished, the young male will possibly come and feed. Very, very seldom do you find leopards feeding together. Kathy, now, this is a question that I think James might be able to help me with. How many cubs has Thandi given birth to? I think it's two, but I'm not sure. James, do you know?
I think it's six.
Is it that many? Okay, so James says perhaps six cubs that she has given birth to. So, so she's obviously done quite well to give birth to that many cubs. And she is the daughter of Karule, if I'm not mistaken, yes. So so she has done well for herself. I'm going to see if I can perhaps, not sure if Ali's back on the vehicle yet. You can see how she uses the front teeth to tear at some of the meat, but usually when leopards are feeding, you'll see she'll probably use the side of her mouth. And the reason for that is they've got something known as a carnassial shear. At the back of the mouth, the back molars and premolars overlap slightly, and that's also where a lot of the power is in the jaw. And so that allows her to feed and break some of those bones that we were speaking about, that they do feed, or that they used to feed. But for the moment, she's in a small little part of the carcass there, so she's using the front teeth able to get to some of that meat. Okay, I'm just going to try and reposition slightly to give some of the other people a chance to view this leopard too. But Ali's back in the vehicle. Let's find out how her search for her leopard is going. This leopard is really enjoying her kill. Crunching away on the bone, still no sign of the other leopard, of her young cub. Thamba, is that correct? Yeah, Thamba, no sign of him. Anyway, just yet, I'm sure he is lying in the long grass somewhere nearby. And hopefully, if we are patient, we may see him return to the carcass and feed a little bit. Oh, listen, was she calling there? Yeah, see, giving a little... Paul Nee Best, you asked if leopards ever bury portions of their kill. Now, I've never heard of that or seen that. I don't think so.
Call me Beth.
Oh, call me.
Get out of the way.
She is contact calling at the moment. Sorry, call me Beth. No, I've never seen a leopard bury any of their kill. They will hoist it into trees, as we know. That's usually when they are trying to store it in a spot out of reach of other predators. I've never seen them or heard of them burying a kill at all. See, she's calling. So hopefully this young cub does come out, or this young male. Just sit and listen for a bit. We might hear some of her calls, her little contact calls that she's giving at the moment. Oh, she's just disappeared there for a second. I'm just going to sit still for a moment. Let's just wait and be patient before we decide to move. Sometimes what can happen is these leopards will move around, and as they're walking through the long grass, they might find each other and return back to the kill. So let's just sit and watch her for a moment. See, perhaps we can hear some of the movements. I'm going to keep a close eye. Oh, there we go. There he is. He's just walked through from right to left. Okay, hold on a second. So he's moved behind us, behind this little thicket in front of us, at the base of that apple leaf. But I'm just going to give it another minute. Let's just wait a minute or so, and then we'll decide where to move. Because they are walking around. That's fantastic. So both leopards are here, which is great. It seems as if he was lying to the back behind that termite mound off to the right. He was lying behind there somewhere. And leopards will often do that. They'll move away from a carcass, lie down in an area, a little spot that they feel safe. So, Dina, no, I can't see any hyena tracks. And if there were any hyena tracks, the likelihood of this kill still being are very, very slim. Because what would happen is the hyena would definitely steal this carcass from this leopard. If it was one hyena, perhaps not. I have seen leopards, and even female leopards, stand off to a single hyena and keep them away. But a hyena, a big hyena, will be able to chase a leopard off quite easily and steal the kill. So this leopard's done well in keeping this kill. It's well hidden right down in this thicket, and at the moment, with all that rain that we had, that moisture also masks the scent, and that long grass doesn't allow the scent of the carcass to travel too far. So that's why the hyena probably haven't found it yet. But Unfortunately, it looks like they've finished most of it. Okay. You know what I'm going to do now is I'm going to move and see if we can't get a view of these two leopards together. I'm just trying to see where that other vehicle is moving first. All right, and speaking about hyena, Ali's on her way to the den. Let's see how close she is. James is apologizing for not turning the ambient sound down. James, please be better. Hang on, I think we're going to get a lovely view of Thamba on the termite mound. Just hold on a second, James. I'll tell you when you can turn the camera. You may now turn the camera, James. To the left, please. Ah, there we go. Look at that. With a vehicle on approach. That's a lovely view of Thamba. Such a wonderful young leopard, quite relaxed. Just trying to signal to the others where these leopards are. And it's always wonderful, as I was saying, this cool weather is so great to view predators because they generally do lie out in the open. They don't need the shelter of the shade. So it gives us a much better view of them. Rachel, that's an interesting question. You said, why is the clouded leopard not part of the Panthera genus? Rachel, I'm not too sure. I would assume it's got something to do with the probably the physical structure of that clouded leopard. If I'm not mistaken, it's much smaller than any of the other leopards. But I don't know. I don't know for sure. James, do you have any ideas or any guesses?
I don't. Can you hear me?
Can you hear James?
I can hear myself. Hello? Hello. Yes.
I affirm we can hear you, James.
The clouded leopard, I think, does not have the characteristic hyoid apparatus that allows it to go... No?
To roar. Yes.
Roar.
That's the hyoid, yeah.
Whereas the snow leopard, I think, does. The clouded leopard, yes, like you say, is more an example of convergent evolution. So where a cat has developed a similar strategy, so there's spots to live in a forested environment, but isn't necessarily related to the other spotted cats. Like a cheetah and a leopard.
Like a cheetah and a leopard, yeah. And also a cheetah does not have that hyoid apparatus,
no,
I believe.
Totally different genus.
Completely different genus, yeah. But the spots for camouflage. Ooh, now,
tiger.
Well, we've been speaking about spots for camouflage on big cats. Now, Ali says she's got something that's camouflaged with stripes. Let's have a look if it's a tiger. Well, Ali, there's been a bit of activity from the young Thamba. He was moving around. That is Thandi that we can see grooming herself. I'm going to try and reposition. Let's see if we can get a better view of them. Hold on a second. Ooh, my vehicle is making an awfully funny sound. That's not good. James, let me know if I'm going to hit anything behind me. Okay, let's see. James, will you let me know if... Is that good? didn't stop. There we go. All right. Just getting James into position. Ah, there we go. Well, beautiful, James. The leaf is in focus. And that is Thandi. I can't. Oh, and on the termite mound, James, if you'd have a look. And Thamba is on the termite mound.
You mean the termite mound behind all the trees?
That's the one, yes. That's exactly. He was right on top. Not really. He just stuck his head up for a second. Briefly, but it just shows he is quite active. He is moving around. And that's a lovely artistic shot there, James.
Thank you.
I think that's brilliant. That's good. Oh, so Nicholas, leopards apparently. Now I wouldn't sound. What's the word? I don't know. I'm doubtful of some of these statistics, but people obviously you have scientists and biologists that study all of this, and they say that leopards see in a bit of a more of a black and white. Vision as opposed to color vision, and apparently it's got to do with the number of, the amount of rods and cones in their eyes, which determines how much of the color spectrum they actually see. I think it's more of a shade black and white as opposed to just black and white, but that is my understanding of it. But I always wonder how accurate are they? Do we you know, James, what do you think? Do you think it's that accurate and scientifically proven and sound?
Yes, I do.
Thank you.
They don't see in black and white. They see in monochrome.
Monochrome, yeah. That's like a shade, yeah. So it's not a distinct black and white, but it is monochrome.
Probably much more like red and green.
Red and green, really? All right. So there you go, red and green, James. I don't know, that sounds made up. Beautiful, beautiful view of her face. You can see there are a few flies around at the moment. That's why she's just shaking her head. But again, she is still fairly out in the open. She's not right under the branches of the tree or the leaves. The young male, still on top of that little termite mound. Oh, no. I might sit here for a little bit longer just to see if one of these leopards do go and feed. We'll see if they move around. But Ellie's managed to find one of my favorite animals.